Like that man said, after New York City, every place else is just cargo.
Thank you. month whether you need them or not. Come and get them.
I could never even get the first baseman in.
Well, because I'm saving it for my wedding night. Oh, get out of here with that laundry.
Okay, but goodbye, cutie. We'll see you next month.
Hey, goodbye, kids. Merry Christmas.
Hi, Annie.
All right, Annie, you call this place clean in the pigsty, Annie. Annie. Where's Annie?
Annie ain't here.
What do you mean?
Annie ain't here.
She did something to Mr. Bundle.
In the laundry bag.
Thank you.
In Hoover they trusted, and now they're busted by Conrad Pegler. Thousands of once affluent Americans are now living in shanty towns called Hoovervilles. Hey, Al, how'd it go today for you?
7 million people in this town, and I can't sell one lousy apple.
And in New York City alone, more than a dozen Hoovervilles. Riverside Drive, Central Park. Hey, here we are, 59th Street Bridge.
Come on, stop! Let's go, Mike! CBS Radio brings you Mom Perkins. Ma's daughter Faye is going to marry Carl Michaels. On Friday, Carl went back to Chicago.
Oh, Carl, don't go back to Chicago!
But no sooner had Carl left town than Dr. Andrew...
Yeah, come in!
Hello, Miss Hannigan, is it?
Oh, yes.
I'm Lieutenant Ward of the 17th Precinct. I found your runway.
Oh!
You! Annie, is it?
Yes.
She was in one of them Hoovervilles down by the river. She had a mangy muck with her, too, but he got away.
Oh, my poor little pumpkin, all freezing! Oh, I hope she didn't catch her death of cold. Oh, thank you so much, officer.
All in the line of duty, ma'am.
Oh.
And you, don't let me ever hear that you run away from this nice lady again. Good afternoon.
Oh, yes, thank you, officer. You! Next time you walk out that door, it'll be 1953. Well, are you glad to be back?
Yes, Miss Hannigan.
Liar! What's the one thing I always taught you? Never tell a lie. What's the one thing I always taught you?
Never tell a lie, Miss Hannigan.
For what you've done, I can get fired. Four orphans sticking their noses in here. I will make you pay for this. I promise you.
Good afternoon, Miss Hannigan.
Oh, yes.
Good, I'm Grace Farrell in the New York City.
Oh, wait a minute. I can explain everything. It was this Annie here. She got into Mr. Bundle's laundry bag.
Miss Hannigan, I...
Well, I should have called Mr. Donatelli instead of the cops, but... Oh.
Miss Hannigan, I haven't the slightest idea what you're talking about.
I get it. Beauty products you're peddling, I don't need any. Get out!
I'm not peddling anything. I'm private secretary to Oliver Warbucks.
Oliver Warbucks? The Oliver Warbucks?
The Oliver Warbucks.
Whoa, I read in Tommy's or Wendell's column, I can't remember where, that he's got more do-re-mi than Tommy Manville.
I wouldn't know, I don't read, Mr. Winchell. Now, Mr. Warbucks sent me to pick out an orphan to spend the Christmas holidays with him at his home.
Well, wouldn't he much rather have a lady? I got 2 weeks coming.
Oh.
All right, what sort of orphan?
Well, she should be friendly and intelligent.
Mississippi, capital M-I, double S-I, double S-I, double P-I, Mississippi.
And cheerful.
Shut up! How old?
Oh, age doesn't really matter. Say 8 or 9, 10, 11.
Yes,
11 would be perfect. And
Good afternoon, Miss Farrell.
Good afternoon, Drake. Has Mr. Warwick arrived yet?
No, miss, but I called Teterboro and his plane from Chicago arrived at 3:30. So we're expecting him any minute.
You will interview, or is this just a train station?
We really live here. Now, has the carpet been set down in the dining room?
Yes, miss.
And has the Steinway been too?
Yes.
Yes, miss. Everything is in order. Mrs. Pugh has prepared Mr. Warbuck's favorite meal.
Fine.
It will be good to see Mr. Warbuck today.
Yes, 6 weeks is a very long time.
Yes.
Now, would you have everyone come here for a moment, please?
Yes, miss. Quickly, everyone. Everyone quickly.
Everyone, this is Annie. She'll be spending the next 2 weeks with us for Christmas. Annie, this is everyone.
Hi, everyone.
May I take your coat, miss?
Will I get it back?
Of course, dear. Now, what would you like to do first?
The floors. I'll scrub them and then the windows.
You don't have to do any cleaning while you're here.
I won't.
Of course not. You're our guest. And for the next 2 weeks, you're going to have a swell time.
Harper
won.
He didn't say. Yes, maybe I could learn to live with that thing. Hang it on the wall there. Great.
Yes, sir.
I'll be wanting my smoking jacket and my brown velvet pants.
Yes, sir.
Mrs. Pugh?
Yes, sir.
Mrs. Pugh, I won't have any time for dinner tonight. I've got hours of paperwork to get through. And Grace, I'll be needing you for dictation tonight.
Yes, sir.
Very good. Good to see you all, everyone. Grace?
Yes, sir.
Dismiss them. Grace, now if you'll be so good as...
Sir, this is Annie, the orphan who will be spending Christmas holidays with you.
The orphan? But that's not a boy. Orphans are boys.
You didn't say you wanted a boy, sir, so I chose a girl.
Oh. Well. Well, I suppose she'll just have to do. Annie, huh? Annie what?
Sir?
What's your last name, child?
Sir, you see, I haven't got a last name that I know of.
No last name?
No, sir.
Just Annie, huh?
Just Annie. I'm sorry I'm not a boy.
Well, I don't suppose you'd like to meet Lou Gehrig.
Oh, boy! Sure!
I couldn't be happier you'll be spending Christmas with us. Now, great, let's start with those figures on the iron ore.
Yes.
What do we do with them?
Well, it is her first night here, sir.
It is? Well, then, I suppose we ought to do something special. Annie, have a seat. Would you like to go downtown?
I heard a lot about it, but I've never been there.
Never?
No, sir.
Well, we'll just have to do something about that in right away. And nothing but the best for you, Annie. Grace, take a note. First we'll go to the Roxy, and then an ice cream soda at Rumpelmeyer's, and then a horse-drawn carriage ride around Central Park. Grace, forget about the dictation for tonight. Instead, you'll take Annie downtown.
Yes, sir.
Ah, gee.
Is something the matter, Annie?
No, it's just that, ah, gee.
What, you don't want to go to the Roxy?
No, I want to. It's just that I thought you were going to take me.
Me? Oh, no, Annie, I'm afraid I'll be far too busy tonight to do that.
Ah, gee.
See, Annie, I've been gone for 6 weeks, Annie. Making a tour of my factories, or, well, what's left of my factories with this depression. Nanny, let me tell you something. When a man is in charge of a multi...
Oh, sure, I know. That's okay, Mr. Orwell.
Bernard Baruch is coming, sir.
Good. Barney.
Yes,
what about you?
Yes.
No, just got back last hour. Right. Why, Detroit and Chicago. Listen, Barney, I don't like what I saw out there. Yes, factory shut down, Barney. My factory shut down. Yeah, you're darn tootin'. If I ain't making money, nobody is. Right. Well, listen, Barney, you've got to tell your buddy Roosevelt that he's got to do something about it, and something right away. Oh, I don't know, something drastic. Why don't you come over tonight, and we'll talk about it. Right. Listen, Barney, change of plans. Yeah, I've got a date tonight. Yeah. Yes, with a 10-year-old girl.
11.
Oh, sorry, she's 11. All right, good night. Drake.
Yes, sir.
Coats.
Yes, sir.
And Grace, you'll be coming too, of course.
Yes, sir.
Will you be wanting the Bentley, sir, or the Duesenberg?
Let's take the Duesenberg. No, no, wait. She's been cooped up in an orphanage, and so we'll walk.
Walk to the Roxy, sir?
Why not? It's only 45 blocks.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Ah, smell that. Fifth Avenue bus fumes. Marvelous. There's nowhere in the world like the air in New York City. And the funny thing is, you don't miss it until you've been gone for a while. It's like that man said, after New York City, every place else is just cool. And why see? What is it about you? You're big,
once again, we bring you the romance of Helen Trent, who sets out to prove for herself what so many women long to prove, that because a woman is 35 or more, romance in life need not be over. That romance can live at 35 and after.
Oh, merciful heavens, I hope so. Good afternoon, Miss Hennigan. Oh, yeah! Look at you, Green Sparrow, a week early. So, Warbucks must be fed up with Annie by now.
Oh, no, on the contrary. Mr. Warbucks is delighted with Annie, and Annie is having the time of her life.
Oh, nice.
They're practically inseparable. They go everywhere together. To the Roxy, to the Stock Exchange. Guess where they had lunch just the other day?
The Waldorf.
The Blue Water.
The Blue Water on 59th?
And she just loves her new coat. Why, she never takes it off.
Never.
Never. Now, I need you to sign this for me to back up at Stonecutter's desk by no later than 10 tomorrow morning.
What for?
Mr. Warbucks is so pleased with Annie that... Guess what?
What?
He wants to adopt her.
How nice. How wonderful. You mean to tell me that Warbucks, that Annie is going to adopt Warbucks and she's going to be the daughter of a millionaire?
No, 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 no. The daughter of a billionaire.
A billionaire. Well, is she coming back?
No. Mr. Warbucks told me to tell you that she will not be coming back here ever.
Ever. My. Excuse me for just a moment, please.
Said I swindled him out of $1,100.
Well, now why would he say that?
Because the rooster swindled him out of $1,100.
Oh, little sis, I'd like you to meet a good friend of mine from...
Jersey City.
Jersey City. Miss Lily St. Regis.
I'm named after the hotel.
Which floor?
Oh, I don't. Now, little sis.
Yeah, I'm nuts about a rooster. Do me a favor. Get yourself and take the St. Regis and just get out of here.
Oh, come on, Aggie.
Oh, can it? I know you. You're looking for a handout.
Nah, I got $80 coming in the mail Thursday. So all I need is 10 to tie
you. Not even a nickel for the subway.
A fiver, Aggie.
Yeah. Fiver, 10, no. With all your big talk, you should be living the high life.
This ain't exactly Buckingham Palace.
Oh, yeah? I'm on the city. I got steady salary, free food, free gas, and electric. I'm doing all right.
Sis, you're doing like we're doing.
Lousy.
Oh, Eddie, how does Hennigan kids ever end up like this? On the skids. Why, I remember the well of sainted mother. What's it, Andrew Nuss? A lullaby.
She'd say, kids, there's a place that's like no other. You gotta get there before you toss.
You can get the vibration from the rule book. The dice.
Mother dear, oh, we know you're
down there listening. How can we follow your sweet advice? to on the way in. Looked like she had a couple of dollars.
Personal secretary to Oliver Warbucks.
The Oliver Warbucks, the millionaire?
No, the Oliver Warbucks, the billionaire, you dumb hotel. Lives up on Fifth Avenue.
Fifth Avenue. He don't live up on Fifth Avenue.
He don't? Where does he live?
Where is Anna?
She's in her room, sir, writing a letter to the orphanage. Should I have...
Yes, please.
Sir, there's no need to be nervous. She's going to be the luckiest girl in the whole world.
You bet she is. And I'm not nervous. Now, call Annie.
Yes, call Annie, please.
Miss Annie, Mr. Warbucks will see you.
Thank you, Mr. Day.
Good morning, Annie. How are you today?
Fine, thank you. How are you, sir?
Very good, very good. Annie, the time has come for us to have a serious discussion.
You sending me back to the orphanage tonight?
No, Annie. Can we have a man-to-man talk?
Sure.
Have a seat, Annie. Annie, I was born right here in New York City, in a part that they call Hell's Kitchen. Both of my parents died before I was 10, and I made myself a promise that one day I was going to be rich. Very, very rich.
That was a good idea.
I made my first million by the time I was 23. And in 10 years, I turned that into 100 million. Let me tell you, Annie, in those days, that was a lot of money. The thing is, making money is all I've ever known or cared about. And I might as well tell you, Annie, that I wasn't always nice to those people I had to climb over to get to the top. Because I'd always believed in one thing. That you don't have to be nice to the people you meet on the way up if you don't plan on coming back down. But lately, Annie, I've come to realize something. That no matter how many Rembrandts or Duesenbergs I've got, if I don't have anyone to share my life with, if I'm alone, then I might just as well be back in Hell's Kitchen. Do you understand what I'm trying to tell you?
Sure.
Good.
Kind of.
Kind of?
I guess not.
Annie, I stopped into Tiffany's the other day and I picked this up for you. I had it engraved.
For me? Gee, thanks.
You're welcome, Annie. It's a silver locket. I noticed that old locket you're always wearing, and I said to myself, that kid's gonna have a nice new locket.
Gee, thanks, Mr. Wilmot. You're so nice to me.
Why don't we try it on? I'll just take this
other one. No, don't make me take my locket off.
Annie, what's the matter?
This locket my mom and dad left with me when they left me at the orphanage. And there was a new note, too, saying they loved me and they were coming back for me. And, I know being here with you, I'm really lucky, but I don't know how to say this, but the one thing I want in the whole world is to be with my mother and father and to be with other kids with both of my own.
Well, Annie, if that's the one thing you want, then that's the one thing you will get. I promise I'll find your parents, Annie. I'll find them for you and I'll get you a brandy.
You just see, if there's anyone in the whole world who can find your parents, Mr. Warbucks is the man.
There's nothing to worry about, dear. Why, if he has to pull every political string there is to pull up to, and including the White House, he'll do it.
The League of Nations.
J. Edgar. Yes, Warbucks here. Listen, Jay, I want 50 of your best men. I don't know, a day, a week, month, however long it takes. Well, put them on vacation. I'll pay for it. Yes, I'll pay all the costs. Good. When can I have them? Tomorrow? Excellent. Good. And Jay, listen. I want that Gunderson fellow. Well, then take him off the Dillinger case. Hip, hip!
Hooray!
Annie, give me your locket.
But Mr. Roberts, I told you that.
I know, Annie, but it could be the best clue we have. I'll give it to the FBI, and they can trace where it was bought, and then they'll find out who bought it.
Okay, and maybe they should have my note too.
You just watch, Annie. In a few days, you could be meeting your real mother and father.
Really?
Really.
Oh boy, I gotta ask the kids about this. Yes.
remember, folks.
Smile, darn ya, smile.
Right, Blackie. Smile, darn ya, smile.
They stand up.
you think I was her mother.
Excuse us, ma'am. Are you the lady that runs, this is your orphanage?
Happened to her.
Hush, Shirley. It's gonna be all right. She's gonna be here and she's gonna be ours again. Ma'am?
Yeah?
Was you working here 11 years ago?
Yeah.
Well, we fell upon terrible troubles back then. And we had to move north to Canada. We had to leave a little baby here on this front stoop.
Our little girl, our Annie. Annie! Your Annie's parents?
Yes, ma'am.
I can't believe it. Where did you say you were from again?
Oh, a little town north in Canada. Where they've got chickens and geese and ducks and roosters.
Gotcha, sis.
Oh, Rooster, I had never known it was you. Not in 100 years.
Fooled you, Eggie, and we're gonna fool Warbucks, too.
Get ourselves 50,000 big ones.
It's gonna be the best Funko job yet. I know a guy out in Brooklyn who could doctor up a fake birth certificate or anything else he'll want.
But, we need your help to give us details about Annie.
Help this hold this thing.
Yeah. You and I could help you lots, but what's in it for me?
Three-way split, Eddie.
Half. Half. Half!
Half! 25 grand. We gotta do it fast, Eddie. Give him the old rooster, razzle dazzle. In and out. 2 or 3 minutes at the most. Get the kid, get the money, and get the heck out of town.
Well, that's the only problem. What do we do with Annie when this is over?
That's not a problem. When I want something to disappear, it disappears. For good. We get the 50 grand. We blow this crummy town, and then Lil and me will meet you.
Where? Oh, yeah.
To none of his lofty campaign promises. All we have had from Franklin Delano Roosevelt and his so-called brain trust is a great deal of high-flown talk and virtually no action. In a nation racked by poverty, misery, and unemployment, it is deeds we want from the White House, not words. In short, Mr. President, if you are listening, we've had enough of your fireside chats. It's time to act.
Crying out loud! Criticism! Nothing but criticism!
I know.
It's just awful.
Did anybody read the Washington Post this morning?
Gentlemen! I say again, the only thing we have to fear is fear itself. There's a silver lining behind every cloud. You're never fully dressed without a smile.
Oliver Warbuck and a friend, sir.
Oh, thank you, Lewis. Show them in. Oliver, how nice of it is for you to come.
Good morning, Mr. President.
And who do we have here?
This is my good friend, Annie. She was just so excited to meet you that I simply couldn't resist bringing her along. Well, just to say hello.
Annie. Ah, yes, the little girl who sang so well on the radio last night.
This is President Roosevelt.
How do you do, President Roosevelt?
How do you do, Annie? And I must say, you look as beautiful as you sounded on the radio last night.
Thank you, President Roosevelt.
Well, shall we get started here?
Yes.
Now, Penny, if you'll just wait outside. Oh, no. No, Oliver, that's all right. She can stay. Having a child at hand will keep us on our best behavior.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Now, Harold, I don't want to hear so much as a gosh out of you. Now, Oliver, you know everyone, of course, but Annie, let me introduce you. Secretary of Labor Perkins, Secretary of State Hull, Acting Secretary of Treasury Morgenthau, Secretary of the Interior Ickes, Secretary of War Wallace, and down there at the end is the Director of the FBI, J. Edgar Hoover. Now, Oliver, since you represent the precious few Americans who have any money left at all, I would like to begin with you.
Thank you, Mr. President. Gentlemen, in the words of Calvin Coolidge, the business of this country is business. And for the good of this country, for the good of Wall Street, for the good of you, and for the good of me, we've got to get my factories back online and the workers back to work.
Why, according to my latest figures here, there are currently 15 million Americans out of work and 50 million with no means of support.
Mr. President, if I may say, unemployment is not our biggest problem. The dispatches from Germany are very troubling. There could be war.
Balderdash! People are starving in this country.
I know that, but in the long run...
Cornell! For Americans who are starving to death, there is no long run.
The trouble is, it's just all happening at the same time. The stock market has taken another nosedive.
Sit-down strikes, riots, floods, dust storms.
And the FBI still hasn't caught Dillinger.
Not enough out of you.
Well... Gentlemen, we are agreed on one thing. The situation is hopeless and getting worse.
The sun will come up tomorrow, so if anybody knows that tomorrow, there will be sun.
Shh, quiet, little girl.
Harold! What did you say, Annie? No, 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 that's all right. Go ahead. This is still a free country.
Just thinking about that.
It's going to be optimistic about the future of this country. Now, Harold, sing.
Well, Franklin,
you heard me sing.
I just take out my gin and drink.
Oh, this is not for me. This is for you, Oliver. It's from your secretary. Hundreds of people jamming street outside of house are claiming to be Annie's parents. Beginning to screen them. Suggest you return New York at once. Signed, Grace Farrell.
Well, Annie, it seems like the Hour of Smiles had more listeners than we thought. Huh?
Hundreds of couples, and one of them found to be my mother's brother.
Well, Oliver, as much as I've enjoyed your company, and especially yours, Annie, I think perhaps you should be getting back to New York at once.
Yes, Mr. President, if you don't mind. Annie?
Bye, everyone.
Bye, everyone.
Thank you.
Goodbye, President Roosevelt, and thank you.
Oh, no. Thank you, Annie. You're the kind of person a president should have around him.
And put the unemployed to work building them. Why, we could create 5 million new jobs within 6 months.
And paychecks would mean all those millions that are on relief could get back to paying taxes.
Why, we could build a country so strong that Chancellor Hitler himself could never beat us in a war.
My FBI caught Babyface Nelson. We will catch Dillinger.
What we've got to create for this country is nothing less than a new outlook, a new vision,
a new approach,
a new concept, a new dedication, a new horizon,
a new spirit,
a new attitude,
a new deal! Gentlemen, Perkins, I was right the first time! The only thing we have to fear is fear itself.
Of the locket in Utica, New York, and that that type of locket was manufactured between 1918 and 1924.
That type of locket?
Yes. Over 90,000 were made. I'm sorry, Annie, but the gist of it is that the FBI doesn't think there's one chance in a million they can locate your parents through the locket. I'm sorry.
That's okay. Gee, you did the best you could. And if you can't find it, nobody can. I guess a kid can get along with helpful. I mean, you did, and you didn't turn out bad, so bad. You got everything. You know that you just embraced hanging on the lock.
Excuse us, sir. We'll check on the new menu.
Annie? Annie, a Duesenberg is an automobile. Lou Gehrig played first base for the New York Yankees. And there's something else I think you should know.
I made me cry.
And ask him to come over tonight to sign those adoption papers.
Yes, sir.
And Grace, I want you to tell Mrs. Pugh that we'll have a house filled with guests. We'll need champagne, we'll need flowers, we'll need caviar.
And cheese.
And cheese.
You know, cheese.
Oh, Eddie, this isn't just going to be an adoption. This is going to be a celebration. We could have anyone in the whole world, Eddie. Who would you like? Lou Gehrig.
Well, I guess I'd like Miss Farrell and Mr. Drake and Mrs. Pugh. Well, I guess I'd like everyone.
That's who I want to. Drake!
Yes, sir.
Drake, I want you to tell the staff to get spiffed up because they're going to be the guests at Annie's adoption party.
Yes, sir.
Oh, and the kids?
The kids. Oh, Annie, I'm afraid it's way past their bedtime. But I tell you what, first thing in the morning, I'll call up and invite the whole orphanage over for a great big Christmas celebration. Miss Hannigan, too. Why not? Annie, I'm the luckiest man in the world.
And I'm the luckiest kid.
Around.
Excuse me, sir, but everyone is stiffed up for the time.
Ah, good, good. Grace!
Yes, sir?
Grace, I think Annie should get spiffed up, too, so... My, Grace, that is a very pretty dress.
Thank you, sir.
Right. Have Annette do something with her hair, and have Colette... Take her upstairs and gussy her up.
Yes, sir, gussy her up.
My friends, welcome. This is the luckiest night of my life. Merry Christmas. Merry Christmas to you. Merry Christmas. Merry Christmas, Drake. Merry Christmas, my good man. Mrs. Pugh, Merry Christmas. Merry Christmas. And to both of you, too. Yes. Merry Christmas. Justice Brandeis, Merry Christmas. Thank you very much.
Annie. Now, Oliver, Annie, let's begin. The adoption ceremony is very simple.
Sir.
Yes.
Sir.
Excuse us, but... Cheryl, look. There's our Annie.
Who are you?
Honey, we're your mom and dad.
Mudge is the name, Ralph Mudge. And this here is the wife, Cheryl.
You never knew it, dear, but you're Annie Mudge.
Annie Mudge? We will shake and broke, honey. Didn't know which way to turn. The man give us a chance. Live up on his farm up in Canada.
Well, we couldn't bring along no baby.
No, we had to leave you behind.
Mr. Mudge, is it? There have been many people coming here saying that they're Annie's parents and...
Well, proof! I expect you've been wanting proof of who we are. Well, here's our driver's licenses and Annie's birth certificate.
Baby girl, Annie Mudge, born October 28, 1922, to parents Ralph and Shirley Mudge.
October 28th, that's my birthday.
It's in the notes, sir.
Yes, Grace, I know, but still, I don't...
Please, sir, you gotta believe us. We get off on the Greyhound this afternoon, went straight down to the orphanage. She don't know Annie. Why, the lady there should have... She was down here.
Oh, Annie, all the years I've dreamed of holding you in my arms again. Now, on the night that Annie...
Oh, here's something you want to know. When we left Annie at the orphanage, we left with her half a silver rocket and kept the other half, so we...
Oh, Ralph, look, she's wearing it.
And here's the other half! Oh, no, it fits perfectly.
Thank goodness, Ralph, she's our Annie.
Well, she seems to be.
Oh, she is. She is. Well, if you'll be getting Annie's things together, we'll be taking her along with us.
Take her? Just a minute, Mr. Mudge. What about the money?
Money? Why, we don't have much, but we'd be glad to.
No, Mr. Mudge. You haven't heard that I've offered a certified check for $50,000 to Annie's parents? You haven't heard?
What? No, sir. We don't know nothing about no check. Besides, we don't want no money anyway.
Right. We don't want no money for our Annie.
The other hand, Cheryl. You remember that pig farm out in New Jersey? Why, with $50,000, we could afford to bring Annie up right in the country. Fresh air, fresh eggs,
fresh ham.
Fresh ham. Sure, if I don't show off, I gotta do is make it up myself.
That's right. Tomorrow morning.
Tomorrow morning?
Yes, yeah, so you don't mind if we keep Annie just one more night. After all, tomorrow is Christmas. Then you can come back to pick up Annie and your check.
Yes. What do you prefer, sir? I think it's best we be gone now. Goodbye, Annie.
Bye, Annie, folks.
Until tomorrow, Annie will be spending the rest of your life with us. Well, bye, y'all. Excuse me, sweetie.
This is wonderful news, isn't it?
Yes, it's wonderful.
Because Annie has found her parents, and they seem to be very nice people, don't they?
Very nice.
Drink.
Yes, sir.
Champagne.
Plus, we need to celebrate, people. This is, after all, Christmas Eve, and Annie has just had the most wonderful news of her life. She has at long last found her real mother and father.
You're lucky, really.
Really lucky. Just think, New Jersey.
Everyone, I propose a toast to Miss Annie Mudge.
Annie Mudge.
Christmas, everybody!
Merry Christmas.
Yes, yes, I seem to have that effect on everyone.
I've lost her. I've lost Annie.
Sir, that Mr. Mudge fellow, I know I've seen him somewhere else, and I have a strange feeling he's not who he says he is.
Mr. President, I need your help.
Certainly, Oliver. Whatever you need.
Merry Christmas, Annie. Early, Annie?
Yes, I guess my mother and father will be coming to get me soon, so I guess I'll just wait for them here. Will you come and see me?
Yes, I'll come see you.
You're up early too.
Yes, we've been up all night, and quite a night we've had of it too, what with these FBI men coming and going. Annie, did you know that President Roosevelt is here?
Really?
Yes. I have something very difficult to tell you, and the President is going to help me. Mr. President.
Merry Christmas, Annie.
Merry Christmas, President Roosevelt.
Franklin.
Annie. Early this morning, I got a very sad telephone call from the director of the FBI. Now, through the paper and the handwriting on the note, they were able to trace the identity of your parents.
Yes, we already know Mr. and Mrs. Mudge.
No, dear. They are not your parents. Your real parents are David and Margaret Bennett.
David and Margaret Bennett? Where are they?
Annie, I'm sorry, but your parents passed away a long time ago.
You mean they're dead?
Yes, dear.
Oh, Annie, are you all right, dear?
Yes, because I guess I always knew that my folks were dead because they would have come back for me if they weren't.
Annie, you're not an orphan. I love you, Miss Annie Bennett.
And I love you, too. Then who the heck are Ralph and Shirley Mudge?
Atta girl. Who the heck are Ralph and Shirley Mudge?
That birth certificate could have easily been forged, but they did know about the locket.
Yes, the locket. That's the key.
But we're the only ones who knew about the locket. Well, and the FBI, of course.
And Miss Hannigan.
And Miss Hannigan.
And Miss Hannigan.
Miss Hannigan, sir, and children from the orphanage.
Oh, Miss Hannigan. Delighted to see you.
Oh, same here. Oh, gosh, I know you will. I know you anywhere. You're the Oliver Warbucks.
Yes. I believe you've already met my personal secretary, Miss Grace Farrell. This is the President of the United States. And I believe you've already met my personal butler, Miss Grace.
Sir, this has just come from the FBI.
Thank you. makes sense.
Annie, come take a look at this.
Listen, listen, who would have guessed?
Sir, Mr. and Mrs. Mott.
Good morning, Merry Christmas, one and all.
Merry Christmas.
Look, Cheryl, there's our little girl.
Yes, your little girl.
Yes, well, we don't want to be bothering you at Christmas, you know, so, we'll just be getting Annie her suitcase and, the check.
Oh, of course, the check. I'd almost forgotten. Why? Here it is, Mr. Mudge, a certified check for $50,000.
Certified, paid the order of Ralph Mudge.
Read it again.
Okay, all right. Paid to the order of the jig is up.
The jig is up, Mr. Daniel Francis Hannigan, also known as
Ralph Mudge, also known as Brewster Hannigan, also known as Danny the Dip.
Mr. President, I believe that fraud is a federal offense, and I believe that your Secret Service agents have the power to arrest.
They certainly do, Oliver. Lewis, turn them over.
Yes, sir. Ma'am, sir, you're out of here.
Officers, I believe you will find that that woman is their accomplice. Arrest her too, please.
Me? Why, I've never seen those people before.
Oh, come off it, Aggie.
Yeah, sis, if we're taking the fall, so is you.
Oliver, Mr. Warbucks, I've never done anything.
The jig is up.
Annie. Please tell them how nice and wonderful I always was to you.
Miss Hannigan, remember the one thing you always taught me is never tell a lie.
Oh, you rotten little brat. I'll let you in on a secret I never liked you.
What a little girl can do to an old man's heart.
Are you sure you're not a Democrat?
I'm quite sure.
Well, Lewis, Eleanor waits to the White House.
Well, Annie, I got something very special for you.
I didn't get anything.
Annie, I don't need anything but you.
Thank you.
early, Annie.
Yes, I guess my mother and father will be coming to get me soon, so I guess I'll just wait for them here. Will you come and see me?
Yes, I'll come see you.
You're up early, too.
Yes, we've been up all night, and quite a night we've had of it, too, what with these FBI men coming and going. Annie, did you know that President Roosevelt is here?
Really?
Yes. I have something very difficult to tell you, and the President is going to help me. Mr. President. Merry Christmas, Annie.
Merry Christmas, President Roosevelt.
Franklin. Annie. Early this morning, I got a very sad telephone call from the director of the FBI. Now, through the paper and the handwriting on the note, they were able to trace the identity of your parents.
Yes, we already know Mr. and Mrs. Mudge.
No, dear. They are not your parents. Your real parents are David and Margaret Bennett.
David and Margaret Bennett? Where are they?
Annie, I'm sorry, but your parents passed away a long time ago.
You mean they're dead?
Yes, dear.
Oh, Annie, are you all right, dear?
Yes, because I guess I always knew that my folks were dead, because they would have come back for me if they weren't.
Annie, you're not an orphan. I love you, Miss Annie Bennett.
And I love you, too.